Since I started this half-baked career, I've reviewed complicated adult dramas, strategic military games, and children's edutainment. I cast a wide net, and I love a little bit of everything the medium has to offer. Through that experience, as well as my own game projects, I've come to understand game design pretty well, I'd say. But sometimes a game comes out that's so complex, so weirdly designed, even my bushy brows get raised. Why did that sound suggestive? Divinity Original Sin 2 is good. So good, I've made more than one video on it. This will be the fourth, in fact. I love this game. But what the hell is this balancing? One of my biggest criticisms of DOS 2 is that it's not particularly accessible. This is mainly because the skills, races, weapons, and such aren't created equally. Spears are extremely rare for no reason. It's easy to stretch yourself too thin when spending your level ups. Dwarves can't see over the steering wheel. It's a mess. I already talked about how elves are amazing, but let's really break down the playable races. Ideally, they'd be mechanically even, each race offering their own distinct flavor with some gameplay variety. In practice, let's just go through them all. Elves. Never before has stabbing yourself been this distressingly normalized. Flesh sacrifice is already better than everything the other races have to offer. It boosts your damage, grants an extra action point enabling you to do more in a single turn, and leaves a puddle of blood at your character's feet. That last part is actually useful because this is a weird game. Being able to take more actions and do more damage is so universally useful, it makes other racial abilities feel situational by comparison. Leaving a blood puddle has synergy with certain talents and abilities. You can use it to make necromancy spells cost less AP with the elemental affinity talent. And you can use it to summon blood totems and blood incarnates which deal high physical damage. It's absurd how many playstyles are enhanced by this one ability. Elves also have the ability to learn free skills from eating certain body parts found in the environment. I know it's tempting, but please don't try this at home. It probably won't work. Probably. Skills normally require very expensive skill books to learn, but in addition to just doing everything 10-20% better, elves can sometimes learn new moves essentially for free. They are too strong, but I wouldn't say that they break the game, especially on tactician mode. I just wish the other races were elevated to that level. Humans. Humans are decent. They get better crits and they get them more often. Encourage is a genuinely good buff, and it slowly but surely scales throughout the game. Since it buffs constitution, I guess it's also a handy pseudo-group heal, and you get 5% better prices. They can basically do anything well, but because of the crit bonus, I'd say that they're best suited to dealing damage. Lizards. I'm not sure what people consider the worst player race, but I'm torn between lizards and dwarves. Now, bear in mind, you can still have a perfectly fine playthrough with either of these races, but in comparison to humans and elves, they're a little lacking. Lizards make good wizards when they're sipping on that scissorp, mainly because they resist fire and poison effects, so they take a little bit less collateral damage from the gas fire that always shows up in every fight. Even when there's no reason for a fire, there's still a fire. They get a free fire breath spell that scales with intelligence, and that's it, really. Not terrible, but definitely one of the weakest. Dwarves. Petrifying Touch is a 1 AP stun that doesn't scale for shit in terms of damage. It has its uses, but only on a melee character, which is a bit limiting. They also get a good bit of extra health and an increased dodge rate. That all sounds good, but then we have to break down this game's combat balancing. Armor works in a pretty unique way in Divinity 2. Instead of reducing the damage you take, your total armor forms an extra health bar. One for physical armor, one for magical armor. These two armors provide immunity to most deadly status effects, including stuns, damage over time effects, stuff like that. Enemies use these effects a lot, so the metagame revolves around having high armor and avoiding taking damage as much as possible. In other words, it favors aggression more than defense. If you lose your armor, you might also be losing turns. Because of this, having a higher HP pool doesn't matter that much. Once you start taking direct health damage, you're kind of already in a losing state. This is why armor restoring and buffing effects are so powerful. This means that while dwarves can take a bit of extra punishment sometimes, it won't help if they're getting stunned to death. So the dwarves' bonuses feel a little pointless, particularly on the higher difficulties. If you're getting hit enough for these bonuses to matter, you're already losing. Both physical fighters and mages tend to have stuns in their movesets, so armor is simply more important than health. This carries over nicely to a key piece of advice. Don't invest many points in constitution. Late in the game, it has some benefit, but in the early game, I'd invest just enough to equip shields. 12 constitution will be enough to use most shields until the mid-game, and for characters who don't use them, just keep it at the base of 10. A few extra HP isn't gonna mean much in most circumstances. Generally speaking, elemental magic deals a lot of damage to groups, archers and necromancers do higher damage to single targets, and warriors and rogues with warfare skills do a bit of both, while being particularly good at stunning enemies. I think this balance is fair in theory, but it's undeniable that physical damage teams are just easier to run with most of the time. Not necessarily because they're more powerful, I'd say they're only a bit stronger, but physical characters are just easier to build and stretch their attribute and ability investments much less than mages do. Warfare has a nice variety of CC in the form of AoE stuns, whereas only Arrow and Hydro mages have good CC access. Well, there's also oil and geomancy that slows people down, and I guess you could argue that since fire and geomancy do a little bit more damage, maybe that's the best crowd control of all. God, this game is complicated. Let's go over the skill schools. You should be spending points on the first section of combat skills, warfare, arrow thurge, that stuff. These grant you more abilities, and this game is all about skills. It'll be best if we go over all these schools individually, so let's get into it. Warfare. Warfare boosts the damage you do with all physical attacks, and offers lots of skills that stun foes, forcing them to lose a turn. This is the bread and butter of your melee unit, and should be a warrior's main skill. Battering Ram and Battle Stomp are powerful AoE stuns, and later skills like Blitz Attack and Phoenix Dive let you warp around the battlefield while doing damage. This school has some of the most consistently useful moves in the game. Huntsman. This is not the most useful selection of skills, even for an archer, but Huntsman does boost the damage bonus long-range attacks get from high ground. This means that sometimes it's worth it to put Huntsman on mages, but usually only later in a playthrough. The bonus damage only applies when you have high ground, and that's not always guaranteed. First Aid and Elemental Arrows are super powerful skills. An elf can use Flesh Sacrifice and Elemental Arrowheads in tandem to deal massive physical damage to single targets using Bloody Arrows. Barrage and Ricochet are decent, and the rest of the skills are just okay-ish. Archers tend to use their basic physical attacks a lot. Scoundrel. Adrenaline is a skill that can be situationally useful on pretty much any build. It gives 2 extra action points on your current turn in exchange for 2 action points at the next turn. I find that this is really useful for dealing burst damage. It lets you strip armor to easily enable stuns or outright kills. It's a nifty option to have, just try not to over-rely on it. Chloroform is a long-range stun that damages magic armor, putting enemies with no magic armor left to sleep. Most of the other skills require a dagger, making this one of the best skills for rogues. The dagger moves focus on damage and a wide variety of debilitating debuffs, a lot of which do damage over time. It's a good school, and if you're using daggers, I'd advise investing in both this and warfare. Investment in the school also increases your critical multiplier and your movement range, which are pretty useful perks. Pyrokinetic. Now we're finally going to get a little controversial. Pyro spells deal high damage and can inflict burning to deal even more damage over time. They also tend to be a little more AP efficient than Hydrosophist and Aerotherge skills. But the thing is, fire is pretty annoying to play around sometimes. Poison and oil explodes when hit by fire, which allows for powerful damaging combos. But if you have melee characters down in the fray, it can often take extensive planning to avoid friendly fire. These attacks are strong, no denying that, and investing just 1 point in the pyro grants 2 of the best buffs in the game, Peace of Mind and Haste. If you're using this school to attack, make sure you think carefully about your friendly fire. Hydrosophist. This school has some of the best support skills and healing spells. Combining rain with ice magic and arrow thurge skills allows for a wide variety of stuns once magic armor has been stripped. It's worth noting that water and fire contradict each other a bit. If a foe is wet, they take less damage from fire and won't be lit on fire right away. If a character is on fire, water will extinguish it and do a little bit less damage, etc. You can have a Hydro and a Pyro on the same party, but you gotta plan around this elemental interaction. Also, if you hit one person with multiple ice projectiles, you can just cause the frozen status that turn. It's pretty cool. The heals and magic armor restoration are also handy for saving party members from death. Overall, a great school, just be careful of how it combines with other schools. Aerotherge. Unlimited power. This is probably my favorite magic school, and that's partially just because lightning and wind magic is just cool, okay? Don't judge me. Air damage isn't often resisted, and the school comes with a nice balance of melee and ranged spells, keeping your mage versatile. Blinding Radiance can blind foes in a large area of effect, reducing physical attack accuracy, and reducing the range of projectile users. Shock and Stun are useful status effects, and the school generally does high damage to multiple foes at once. Also, Teleport and Nether Swap are some of the most tactically useful moves in the game. You can use Teleport to group up enemies, move around the environment, and keep powerful melee foes away from your party. Nether Warp lets you switch the location of any two characters, friend or foe, yourself, and others. I don't think I need to explain why that's good. This is a great school, and a must for battle mages. Geomancer. Another great, versatile magic school. This is the only school that offers a significant amount of two damage types, poison and earth. Most earth spells create oil surfaces that can slow down the movement of anything that stands or walks through them. Poison surfaces damage foes that move through it. You also get skills that restore and boost physical armor. Overall, this school does a bit of everything, making it a school I'd recommend the most if you want to make a versatile mage that can hurt foes and help allies in equal measure. Necromancer. This is the main way mages can deal physical damage. You get long-range attacks and debuffs like Mosquito Swarm, which also heals the caster based on the damage dealt. Shackles of Pain forces an enemy to take damage whenever you get hit. Decaying Touch deals damage and makes healing spells damage the target. In addition, increasing this skill grants a health drain effect on any attack, making it useful for keeping your character's vitality up. Later spells are very powerful, and it's generally a solid option with a wide variety of effects. Summoning. A friend of mine kinda hates how much I use this skill, but I like conjuring minions in games, so he can bite my ass. Love you, bro. In all seriousness, this skill can prolong your turn by quite a bit, which might be annoying in a multiplayer session. Just something to keep in mind. This school largely revolves around summoning and buffing minions to fight for you. They tend to be much more fragile than party members, but are really useful for stuns, damage, and distracting enemies. If you summon an incarnate on an elemental surface, they gain extra defense and power, as well as extra spells. You can make a foe bleed and summon a blood incarnate next to them for some extra physical damage, or summon them on fire to gain the fireball spell and immunity to flame damage. It's a good school, but you'll end up using the same few basic moves over and over again. Polymorph. This weird grab bag of skills involves altering the form of yourself and others. It's a complementary ability. Every point you invest into it grants a free attribute point to spend as you wish, allowing you to increase your damage, health, all kinds of stuff. The skills here generally complement the skills of other schools without much of a specific focus. Some abilities enable fast and versatile movement, such as Spread Your Wings, which lets you ignore surface damage from things like poison and fire, or slow down from oil. Bullhorns give you a rushdown move that can plow through multiple foes in an area and cause bleed. Tentacle Lash prevents foes from using their weapons. Heart of Steel regenerates physical armor every turn. It's generally a skill that can be used to enhance every other playstyle, but I recommend not using it as your primary focus. It's a support school for sure. And that's all the schools. While certain schools are certainly more versatile and effective than others, it's impressive that the team made every group of abilities feel so useful. The variety of character builds lends a lot of replay value, and I haven't even gotten into the skills that combine two schools. Maybe I'll tackle that in a future video. For now, hey, thanks for watching. If you want more content on this game, let me know, because I've barely scratched the surface. If you want to know how to support my work, like the lovely people on screen right now, you can do so by pledging to support me on Patreon or make a one-off donation. Links to that stuff in the description. And hey, check out my anime channel. Until next time, stay safe out there, nerds.